Very good morning to all my dear friends. I am Prashant Mauni. I warmly welcome all of you to Study IQ. Let's start our day with a positive quote. A person who has health has hope, and a person who has hope has everything. Arabic proverb applies on all of us. Dear friends, the thing is that whatever we are trying to achieve, or our vision, our dreams, depends on our healthy body. If we lose health, then we lose hope, and then eventually we lose everything. So make sure you look after your body very well. A bit of exercise, 5, 10 minutes, 15 minutes of exercise is more than enough, I must say. Right? It's not necessary that you have to spend hours and hours in the gym. But look after your body, take enough rest, take enough quality food, as well as a bit of exercise is something that is very important. There is no substitute of a little bit of physical exercise. It includes walking or weightlifting, whatever you like, right? But make sure you add something in your regime or your daily routine. With this, dear friends, StudyIQ has added many pen drive and tablet courses recently, GPSC. Then we have optional philosophy paper for UPSC, test series, and many more things. So make sure you check out studyiq.com to know more about it. Now, today we have many important news items as well as articles, many news items. So we'll be a bit quick when we go through news item. Of course, I won't compromise with the quality, and you know it very well that you would be able to download this file later on. So if you require, then just go through or read the lines once again. But of course, I will provide you the gist in the main thing that is there in the news. So let's start with the first article. This is something that we have talked about yesterday in detail. Section 377 of IPC, right, which criminalizes gay sex. Now the thing is that Supreme Court is going to look after this thing, whether this thing is valid or not, and things like that. The most important thing to understand here is that it directly or it is directly related with our, you can say, a right to privacy as well as freedom, right? It is part of our fundamental right. Now, the thing is that if you see the judgment of 9-judge bench, for those of you who have recently started preparing for competitive exams, if you're not sure about the history of this Article 21 and the, you can say, all those hurdles through which it has gone through back in 1954 and 1962, you have this famous case of Kharak Singh. So I have added this picture here. You can go through it, but I will provide you the gist of this thing. Of course, it is not mentioned in today's Hindu, but I was having this picture, so I thought let me share it with you guys. It will add a bit of background knowledge regarding how this whole thing started, and basically it is important as well because a fundamental right is something that is part of your syllabus, as well as you find questions pertaining to fundamental rights every year, right? So clear understanding, right? I'm not saying you to remember the articles. What I'm trying to tell you here is that you should understand, you should be knowing the gist of what this Article 21 or any other fundamental right are trying to tell you. So finally, in August 2017, Supreme Court declares right to privacy as fundamental rights under the Constitution. The Supreme Court at that point of time said that even though it is not clearly written that right to privacy is fundamental right, it is there in every fundamental right. That's what this 9-judge bench, right, 9-judge bench, constitutional bench said back in 2017. And it is quite interesting to note here that Supreme Court is going to undo the judicial wrong that was conducted by it in 2013. A larger bench is going to look after this Section 377 of IPC. This is the beauty of our Constitution. It is flexible enough. One thing before I tell you about flexibility and rigidity, first thing, very fundamental thing to understand about our Constitution is that Constitution is like a rule book, right? For a sport of cricket or football, you need some rules and regulation, right? Everyone has to follow that rules and regulations, or if no one is following it, then there is no, you can say, charm of playing a game of football or cricket or whatever. So in the same way, rules and regulations, or all the powers or all the things that we see in our society, the state and how we should behave and fundamental rights and all these things come from Constitution. It is basically a sort of, you can say, a rule book, right? Now, the beauty of our Constitution that I was talking about is that it is flexible enough as it is for society, so it should be able to address all the changes, or it should be up to date with the changes that are taking place in the society. And that's what our constitution is, right? Whenever we see that society has changed, at the same time the constitution is updated as well. At the same time, it is rigid enough if the state or the government is trying to exercise extra power which goes against the society at that point of time, constitution becomes bit of rigid, right? Because of different ways, or you can say methods, are laid down, so you cannot change it. A government in power cannot change the constitution as per its whims and fancies. So here's the bench has rightly observed that social morality changes from age to age. You know it very well. We talked about this thing, and you can observe it from your life experience as well. 5 years, 10 years ago, the things that used to be taboo topics, now you can freely talk with your friends or your family or in the classroom, isn't it? So the morality, and I would like to quote here the Supreme Court, that the morality that public perceives the Constitution may not conceive of, and that what is natural to one may not be natural to another. So this is a right stand by the Supreme Court. Again, in this Justice K.S. Puthaswamy versus Union of India, Supreme Court said that equality demands that sexual orientation of each individual in the society must be protected on an even platform. The right to privacy and the protection of sexual orientation lie at the core of fundamental rights guaranteed by Article 14, 15 and 21 of the Constitution. With this, dear friends, back in 2009 as well, the High Court, Delhi High Court, it struck down this Section 377, but it was the Supreme Court who restored it. So now it is believed, or you can say that the Supreme Court is going to get rid of this Section 377 that criminalizes gay sex, a consensual sex between two adults, right? And again, this gender identity and sexual orientation are part of privacy, personal freedom and dignity. So these are the things, and of course, as we have discussed yesterday as well, this is something that we will find in future as well. More articles will be written on this thing, and we have more discussions to do on this particular topic. Make sure you keep a good grip on this thing, because you may find a question in your mains examination pertaining to this thing. They don't ask you or won't ask you about IPC and things like that. Those sort of things are not part of your syllabus, particularly UPSC and other national exams. If you are preparing for some state level police recruitment exam, then they may ask you this sort of question, so keep this thing in mind as well. With this, dear friends, this is about a tragic incident that took place, right? Bajira, one of India's breeding tiger. On Sunday we talked about this thing, and if you have heard, or if you were present during that, or if you have gone through this at the last Sunday's Hindu analysis in Hindi and English, then you might be aware about this thing that we talked about many different ways. Remember, we talked about this underpasses, or you can create a sort of infrastructure. So basically here as well, the core of this article is, one of the core is, or one important point is about infrastructure. The government is not that sensitive when it comes to infrastructure, particularly associated with wildlife. Now, the thing is that it is very sad. One of the most protected species in our country, that is tiger, becomes a victim of a hit and run case, isn't it? And it is not just the tiger. We see many endangered species, right? Like snakes and amphibians and butterflies and other things. They fall, or they become victim of this sort of human misbehavior, I must say, right? It is clearly, if you are driving from a jungle road, then of course there are some things that an adult should be aware of, that every door should be locked, your windows should be up, and you should be driving at a reasonable speed. Over speeding, if you do this sort of things, then you know that you are going to hurt a very precious, or any, every animal is important. It is part of ecosystem. It has a role to play. Now, the thing is that it is not the first time, on many times, right? National Highway Authority of India and the central government, both these bodies have been repeatedly advised by National Board of for Wildlife. And many independent researchers as well have urged central government as well as National Highway Authority to build roads and keep in mind this interaction that takes place between human beings and wildlife, and of course the loser or the party that loses or is in, you can say, loss is of course the wild animals. So we should build this sort of infrastructure, and I have some suggestions here, right? Some things are mentioned in this editorials, like this user fee, but these are my suggestions. Like, we should have proper signs and warning, we can deploy CCTV cameras or anti-speed roads, you can have multiple speed breakers, then you have you should have this speeding cameras as well, so you can capture pictures and then you can find those people. Of course, this is something reactive rather than proactive. Proactive things are going to be this anti-speed roads and proper signs and warnings and educating people about it. You can have this barricades so that before entering this area, you can warn the people, right, briefly, very briefly, that make sure you follow road, CCTV, you are under surveillance, don't overspeed and things like that. And then you can also have this escorted convoys where forest jeeps, you have like 5 or 10 cars you can take, right? And they are being means escorted by this forest department's jeeps and things like that. So these are the things, and we know it very well that if you isolate animals, if their free movement is hindered with, then their genetic diversity is not going to expand, and eventually we may lose them. So this is a very serious thing indeed. But this this is a very important article on agriculture. Many important things to learn from this article, right? And this is this article is talking about or the things that are being talked or written in this article are very true in nature as well. Now the thing is that we have seen recently in Gujarat, of course this is not mentioned in this article, but I would like to help you with, or you can say discuss this thing with you guys with a practical example. Now one of the reason, if you are aware about the recent outcome of Gujarat election, then we know that for BJP, right, Gujarat is a sort of hub, right? It is a fort of BJP, but then as well it faced a very tough battle in this the recently concluded legislative assembly election. And it is believed that farmers, many farmers of parched area of Saurashtra, they were not happy happy with the Modi government or BJP, because they are not able to benefit out of all the economic progress that we see in that is taking place in our country, right? And in general as well, for a very long period of time, it is not only about NDA government. This thing used to take place in UPA government as well. And I'm sure that many of you would be having someone and someone who is engaged with agriculture, because in our country, more than 50% of our population is associated with agriculture. So it is quite natural that we know someone, or we would be coming from a family of farmers, isn't it? So you might be having a sort of common sense or common understanding, basic understanding regarding the situation of farmer. And I'm not sure whether you are aware about this thing, but if you compare Indian farmer with a farmer of USA or some other developed country like Netherlands, then you find that their life is altogether different. If you see the farmers, you don't believe that they are farmers. They are having all those luxuries that one can aspire for. And here the situation is quite bleak. And one of the reasons is that when it comes to supporting farmers, the government talks about it quite a lot of time. We see release of Kisan TV and many advertisements, particularly in DD News and Rajya Sabha TV and Lok Sabha TV. Throughout a day, you will find many advertisements that are for the betterment of farmer. But these are the things. Or you can say things on book, but when it comes to practical side, we don't see or the results are not that much visible. And one of the basic reason behind this thing or farmers' distress is absurd policies, right? Absurd policies. And this is something that he's talked here by this writer of this article, that farm incomes are unattractive for a variety of reasons, and the main blame goes to absurd policies. Now let's see this A, B, C and D that is in the next page. Now A, point number A is overriding objective of price stability. Let me clear this thing out for you. Right, so this basically means that when it comes to we have two group in general. One is producer and one is consumer, right? Or you can say the farmers and consumers. We play a different role, right? A farmer would be consumer as well at different point of time. But generally speaking, farmers, they produce things, right? Food items. And then we have consumers in the market who purchase those things. Now, to keep this large vote bank of consumers happy, right? What government does is that it designs policy in such a way that the products that are purchased by consumers are always as low as possible in price. So what happens naturally is that farmers are not going to get that much profit out of it, isn't it? So this is something that is this sort of policies are tilted in favor of consumer. And it is a very sad thing as well. If you observe or if you think about this thing, then see, we want to see our farmers in a very financially healthy position. But when it comes to price rise, we all become very selfish, right? If the price of lemon will go up by 5 rupees, then we are not happy about it. But we don't think this, or we don't take this thing in consideration, that a price of you can say that rise of 5 rupee in lemon, eventually it is the farmer who is going to earn 2 rupee per kilo more. So this is something that is lacking in, and it is not only, it is not about patriotism or something, but this is how government is designing its policy, right? It is tilted towards consumer. The second thing is you have this trade and price control thing, highly restrictive and mostly anti-farmer. Now trade and price control things, limited amount of stock you can keep. The other thing is that when domestic prices are low and when international prices are high, at that point of time restrictions are kept on trade, and because of this thing farmers are not able to make money. The other thing is that you have this marketing yards, right? Agriculture market produce committee, and this sort of things are playing as a middle. There are so many middlemen, and farmers are not able to sell their produce directly to consumer, and this is also not helping them in earning extra money, the money that they should be entitled to. Many a times you find that things that are sold by the farmers to the traders at, say for example, 2 rupees per kilo, that particular thing will be sold in the market to the final consumer at say 10 rupees, right? So the maximum money is being earned by the middlemen who are just trading things. Then you have this government's extra protection being given to this inefficient fertilizer industry to ensure that this fertilizer industries are making profit. They have been protected, and eventually what happens is that input costs goes up, and this again reduces the profit that is earned by the farmers. And this thing has been, I think we have discussed this thing, that farmers are forced to sell their produce in domestic market, even though when the prices are high in a global market, they can earn huge amount of money, but this demand and supply benefits are not being able, you can say they are, farmers are not allowed to take benefit out of it. Now, talking about this agriculture markets, they are not free. Government keeps on influencing prices. As we know, this is one of the main reasons, right? A numerically large vote bank. And there are some tools in the hands of the government through which it can maintain or it can keep a fine balance. Import and export controls, demand and supply. We have talked about this thing. I'm sure you know what demand and supply is all about. If the demand is high and if the supply is low, then prices are going to go up. If the supply is high and the demand is low, then naturally the prices are going to go down. In the same way, when you have opportunity abroad, right, you should allow to export things. When you have stocks are limited in our country, then imports should be allowed. Then we need a better buffer stock management. We know that tons and tons, right, crores of tons of things go wasted many a times, rats many a times, lack of proper storage facilities destroys things, and at the other hand we have many people who are forced to sleep hungry. When it comes to MSP, that is minimum support price, very important thing here, the MSP, the price at which the government offers to procure from farmers, is an economic policy tool, right? Basically, farmer, there is a price that is set by government, say for example 10 rupee per kilo of rice, right? If the farmers are not able to get this much in the market, then the government will purchase 1 kilo of rice at the rate of 10 rupees. This is called MSP, right? Minimum support price. Now, it is an economic policy tool and it is a very technical thing, right? It is, we have to take out political calculations out of it. And one example here is this pulse, a mistake that we did in 2016. We had the MSP was declared and MSP was quite handsome enough, so many farmers opted for pulse production. Earlier on we were having a shortage in pulse, and because of this thing there was a crisis and inflation was going up and things like that. So when pulse's prices were good enough, or MSP was good enough, the production went up. So we had enough stock, but at the same time government allowed imports of pulses. So you can see we have now, in 2016-17 there was a situation in which we had enough, or you can say more than enough supply, and again this demand and supply thing applies. The prices went down and farmers were not able to make money out of it. So this sort of things, this sort of steps by the government, when they are not technical, they are going to bring losses to us, right? The other thing is that other things that are talked in this, or important bits here, is advice from chief economic advisor, former chief economic advisor Kausik Basu, has also said about this reluctance of releasing stocks to cool rising price. What happens is that government procures or purchases this stock in huge quantity, and when the prices are, say for example, down, the government thinks that it's better to keep the stock rather than releasing this stock in the market, keeping in mind the fiscal deficit or the loss that it will bring to exchequer. But there are many studies that prove that if you keep the stock for a very long period of time, you are in fact creating more losses than you create loss whilst if you release this stock. Then this Ashok Gulati, right, agricultural economist, he says that MSP that is provided by India to our farmers is quite less when we compare it with the support price provided by China and other Asian countries. And this is a big, you can say, betraying India's buyers in favor of consumer. This is because the government policies are tilted towards consumer. And very interesting lessons that we can learn from China. Back in 1978, when China started reforming its economy, at that point of time, it one of the main focus was to overhaul this agriculture sector. And because China overhauled or repaired its agriculture sector, it was able to bring down poverty level in a huge number in just 6 years. But in 1991's reform, right, we focused more on industries and we ignored this agriculture altogether. And because of this thing, we were not able to lift up people from poverty. Or even when we lift, or the figures are not as good as China, you can say. So basically we have a budget just around the corner, so it is a very good opportunity for our country to reform and to sort out the things that are not right with our agriculture sector. This one is about Iran, right? Crisis brewing in Iran. This is the country of Iran here. You can see here it is sharing border with Pakistan, Afghanistan, Turkmenistan, and then you have Iraq here as well. We know the rivalry going on between Saudi Arabia and Iran, rivalry between USA and Iran. So basically, Iran is going through, or has been going through, you can say, foreign pressure for a very long period of time. Because of this Iran nuclear program, nuclear weapon program, it was under sanction. And you can understand that whenever a country is under sanction, then naturally its economy is going to face the pressure, isn't it? Now, what we see here at present is because of curbs that were applied on usage of social media. And for a very long period of time, if you are aware with current affairs, if you have been reading and up to date with news, then you might be knowing this thing that many a times we find this news items that Iranian women are not allowed to use social media. And recently the government has came out with a policy that has curbed the freedom to use social media, and this has kicked a very big protest that is going on, or you can say it is growing in numbers, and the pressure is growing on Iranian government. Now, this reminds of 2009 Green Movement. At that point of time, this Green Movement in Iran was something that was started by urban middle class youth in Tehran, that is in capital, right? Generally speaking, the bigger cities and urban middle class youth. But now what we see here, this protest are not by urban middle class, but it is coming from lower and working class, and they are not happy about this unjust and unequal management of Iranian economy. As I told you that foreign policy plays a very important role for Iran because it is an oil exporting country, and when it was under sanction, so naturally it faced the economy was not doing right. Apart from that, it is engaged in supporting a war that is going on in Yemen as well as Syria. Then rivalry, as I told you, between the Shia Sunni thing and USA and the rivalry of USA and Iran for a very long period of time. Now, interesting thing, things that took place in Iran in this many years. See, back in 1979, right, there was a king in Iran. He was, you can say, a puppet of USA. So all the things that he used to do was for the interest of USA. And there was a big protest in 1979. There is a very famous film called Argo. I'm not sure whether you have watched it. A very interesting movie, right? And this is inspired from a true incident, how this USA's embassy was attacked by these protesters. And since then, diplomatic ties are not right between USA and Iran for a very long period of time. As you can see, more than 35, 40 years we are talking about here. So this was a big protest, and since then we see consistently, not exactly 10 years, but every decade you find some sort of protest going on. The Green Movement 2009, now you have this one. This is a quite bigger one, and the things that have changed in Iran and around the world, we know that nowadays we have access to social media. We know the way of life or the quality of life that people live in developed countries and the people live in third world countries and developing countries. So of course, naturally, everyone would like to live in a better country or in a better society. So aspirations are quite high in youths. The other thing is that there is a big divide. There is a generation gap in Iran that is seen. There are people in power who are, you can say, they are quite elderly, and the youngsters, right, they are seeking this new changes, and because of all these troubles that are going on, they are not been able to get all these benefits that they should or that they require or aspire for. Now, back in this last year, 2017, re-election of Mr. Rouhani, he came back in power, and he promised that he is going to change things. Economic things will change, and eventually other things too. And he has not been able to deliver. And this is creating this sort of troubles. As you can see here, 40% of youth are unemployed in Iran. The other thing is that this youth of Iran backed this nuclear deal between USA or world community and Iran because they believed that lifting of sanctions and things will make their society a bit more democratic, bit more better, but they have not seen any sort of this sort of changes. So this is creating problems, and the world community or the global community when it comes to Iran. USA is supporting this protest, but the other countries are quiet on this thing. And generally speaking, you can say that they are saying that it is unpredictable and the problems in Iran are still not over. So this is going to not stop in near future. This is about, this is an interview of a former diplomat of USA. At present, he is a professor. He has worked for 27 years as a diplomat, right? And he talks about most of the things that you find in this article. I'll give you a gist, is basically about, you can say, negative things that have been done by Mr. Trump. He says that it is the way fundamental departure, the administration of Trump is fundamental departure from 70 years of American foreign policy. He also talks about this tough stand taken by Mr. Trump. Basically, USA is an immigrant nation. The other thing is that from a world platform as well, USA is stepping out. Paris climate change is a very good example. And then he says that he ignores the value of democracy and other strategic issues, which are very important for a country like USA, India, Japan, and other countries when we compare it with Russia and China. And the president has not been consistent in this sort of things. There is a rise of right-wing populism. You know this France and Netherlands and other, luckily, they are not able to win the election, but there is a rise. So this is something to worry about for the country who are following democracy. And when it comes to relationship between India and USA, trade and other things are going on well. Mr. Trump recognizes India as its partner. So these are some of the good bits that are talked in this article or interview. With this, dear friends, we reached to news item very quickly. As you can see, we are being beaten by the clock, so I will be a bit quick here. India and USA, UK are going to ink illegal migrant pacts. We know that many illegal migrants many illegal Indians, right? Indians are living illegally or overstaying in UK, and the process should be sorted out as soon as possible. So hopefully in near future, we'll see a sort of pact. And Vijay Mallya case will also be discussed. Home Junior Minister is going to visit UK. He's going to carry a delegation and they are going to talk about this Vijay Mallya expedition. Playing national anthem in cinema halls made optional. Right, 12-member inter-ministerial committee has been established to recommend further actions. At that point of time, new rules will be notified. Guidelines will be notified, but the Supreme Court has decided to make it optional. It will depend on the discretion of the theater owner. H-1B visa rule, it was discussed from last 10 days. There were, people were worried about this thing, but USA has clarified that it is not going to change its stand. So it is going to be a sign of relief for Indians living there. Now, this one is about hanging, or you can say basically it is about death penalty, right? At present, the government has said that we don't have any other viable method at present when it comes to death penalty. Hanging is the only option that we have. There are different countries that practice different sorts of death penalty. India is practicing hanging, and basically there is a demand of lethal injection of a bit of, you can say, more less painful way of execution. This one is about Kambala fire. Julio Ribeiro, he is known as Super Cop. We have talked about him earlier on as well. He has taken a stand and he has his own suggestions. He has urged the court to take a tough stand, and there are some procedures that should be followed, because this incident that took place, fire incident that took place in Kamala Mills, has killed many people. PIOs make a mini world parliament. This is about Pravasi Bharatiya Divas. You know, the return of Mahatma Gandhi from South Africa is celebrated as Pravasi Bharatiya Divas. And it is basically a soft power. Now we see here, with the help of this map, let me quickly tell you that, see here, these are the countries where you find people of Indian origin. Either they are parliamentarians, or either they are president or prime minister. And there are many different countries. And you know, this works as a soft power, right? The history, it has a history behind it. because of different colonial powers that took Indian people to different countries for different purposes. But now they have their fourth and fifth generations living here, and their education and their active participation in other things have helped them reach this high position. And this is a soft power. So this helps us when we want to make necessary changes in global forums like United Nations or Security Council and things like that. Netanyahu, Israeli Prime Minister, is going to be here in India, and an open Jeep, you can say, road exhibition will take place, just like things happened between India and Japan. And he is going to visit a center of excellence pertaining to farming, right? Israel is very advanced when it comes to scientific farming, something that India requires, right? Food wastage, and we talked about farming quite right in detail, so you can apply or connect these things with it. Akash, short-range surface-to-air missile, army is happy about it, satisfied about it, and this are the range and some technical speciality regarding Akash. Easy read ones, so I'm just going through it very quickly. Maldives and China had their free trade agreement. India is not happy about it. And foreign minister of Maldives is going to visit India. You can see here, this is the country here, Maldives. And interesting thing is that Equator is passing through this island nation. So keep this thing in mind. Capital is Male, not far from India. Part of SARC, part of Indian subcontinent as well. South Korea, North Korea, things are looking a bit good, as you can see that they are shaking hands with each other, and they are going to take part in the Winter Olympics. Some news pertaining to economy and business world. Telecom Commission agrees with TRAI's recommendation of to remove 50% limit on spectrum. Now, the better we, or the good health of telecom sector means it will promote more growth. And here is a thing that you can connect. There are two different items, but you can see here digital pay or digital, you can say, transactions are going up. Figures are right in front of you. And this one is about net direct tax collection has gone up to 18.2%. Direct tax comprises income tax, corporate tax, and wealth tax. With this, dear friends, these are your answers, Uttar Pradesh and Dig Boy. And these are your questions. The largest tribe group of India is Bhils, Gonds, Santhals, and Tharus. Identify the known greenhouse gas: methane, nitrous oxide, sulfur, hexafluoride, and carbon monoxide. Ozone layer present in our atmosphere absorb cosmic ray, infrared rays, ultraviolet rays, all this above given rays. And identify this picture here. Very interesting. It is not just for fun. It will remind you about a very important thing associated with our history. With this, dear friends, I end this discussion. I will see you all soon. Enjoy your studies. Jai Hind.